Hi, and welcome to this lecture on cultural participation. All right, there we are. Okay, so today I would like to talk a little bit about cultural participation and agency. We're going to talk about the chapter 5 in the course literature in Brands et al., which is the only chapter that deals with these issues. And then we'll talk about my own studies in the field, which I conducted on the LGBT dating platform, Cruiser. And then I will end this with some kind of general concluding thoughts from my studies in this field of participation on different levels. So this is the lecture today, and as always, if you're coming to class, do send me an email answering the following two questions. A, was there something you didn't understand you want me to elaborate on? Two, is there anything you would like to discuss further? Okay, and do watch this before coming to class as usual. All right, so let's start. So cultural participation. Well, I mean, the idea here, if we return to my tripartite delineation, and the idea here is that political participation may occur outside the parliament and not be directed towards it. So it's more generally concerns meaning making, hence a very anthropological understanding of culture as connected to meaning making, and it's also if we return to the wide narrow definitions of participation. This is, I would say, the widest definition of participation, because it can happen everywhere, or perhaps even the more maximalist. Well, I'm perhaps not maximalist, because I know that the maximalist minimalist more suggests power differentiation. So let's stick to the widest, is the widest notion here. So it concerns political art, for example, mashups, remixes, etc. I mean, I think this is an excellent example here of the artist Saint Hoax portraying world leaders as drag queens in the project War Drags You Out. So this is one example of perhaps commenting politics and participating politically in the cultural sphere, so to speak. This whole field is very influenced by, and myself, I've been very influenced by the Dutch scholar Yogi Hermes and her theorization of exactly cultural participation and what she called the cultural public sphere, with reference, of course, then to Habermas and the Habermasian understanding of the public sphere. So, I mean, yes, culture here is a very anthropological understanding of culture in the sense of understanding culture as revolving around meaning-making, identity and meaning-making practices. So it's assuming an idea of a sense-making agent, that we make sense of this society around us. And this we can do in so-called cultural public sphere. And Jokic's understanding here, or her argument, is that the popular culture offers images, symbols that evoke emotions, affections that we use when we negotiate civic identities. And these identities are then important for participation and opinion formation. So this is very important, according to her. So she considers then popular culture and the arena of popular culture as a site of knowledge production, value negotiation, and as spaces that do provide spaces for identity negotiation, inclusion, exclusion, as well as political participation. So this is what you mean then, that the culture is, can also be considered a public sphere, and with her idea of the cultural public sphere. And as Keane rightly, I think, argued in his article, book chapter from 2000, that music, opera, sport, painting, and dancing were among the first forms of communication giving rise to public life in the first place, and contemporary counterparts should therefore be understood as legitimate loci for the political. So we should not exclude these popular cultural arenas when looking at sites for the political, where the political can happen and where thus participation may occur. So basically, the basic idea here is that non-institutional online arenas, not primarily directed towards decision makers or to the parliament, may become spaces for political participation. And not only Hermes has made this argument, I mean, John Street already in 1997 talked about culture and politics in his book, and Lisbeth van Sonen has also been talking about this. So this is not an outrageous argument in that sense. There are many scholars who have been talking about this. The interesting thing, though, as Voyager and Mutz outlined in their article 2009, if we're going to now transport this idea of cultural participation to the internet and to the online, there is very little research, and we know very little about how internet users participate in non-explicitly political online communities to discuss politics. And also, I guess the course literature, the Brandstedt All book that we have here, is an example of this, because they have section 2, which deals with activism, and section 3, which deals with social media and election campaigns. But it doesn't deal with social media and political talk and political participation outside these two domains, so to speak. But there has been some studies made here. I mean, for example, we know that when political participation occurs in online communities not primarily directed towards decision making, it has been understood as participation taking a political turn without the intention to do so. And Todd Graham's dissertation, where he, among others, studied and this is the picture in the background here, the docu-soap Wife Swap. I don't know if you know it, but basically two families, they swap the wives. So the women in the families live with the other family, and this is supposed to be fun to watch. Some kind of docu-soap here. And what he shows is that, I mean, in these online fan posts here, what you say, in these online discussion forums docu-soaps, there were very political discussion that were, according to Todd Graham here, very political and also very deliberate in their nature, very Habermasian discussions, actually. But there is this idea that political might pop up, political discussions. Other examples are sports, for example. Soccer, when a soccer club hires someone from Brazil, someone perhaps with another color, black color, and all of a sudden they start to discuss racism because this player might not have been accepted into society, or maybe they have not. There are many different, the political discussion that deals, remember my definition of the political as concerning the organization of society in general. These discussion concerning this may pop up all over this popular cultural sphere. However, this also concerns not only, discussion forums of docu-soaps or sport fan page where all of a sudden political discussions take a political turn, but there are also spaces on larger affinity portals to which political interested users are directed. One example is Cruiser, which is a community for LGBTs trying to find a date, but still there are sections of this community, there are forums where they can discuss politics, as well as in other communities, such as, for example, if you're an emo, or if you're a hard rocker, or something, there are communities online where you gather because of your musical preferences and clothing style and your general subcultural youth culture identity, and where you also might end up discussing politics. And one very interesting dissertation in Sweden was Erik Andersson's dissertation from 2013, where he actually studied one of these community and how political discussions popped up in a community that was not primarily targeted to. Well, it didn't pop up because it was direct. There was a particular forum there that was concerned political discussion, where people who wanted to discuss politics were directed. Now, the interesting thing here in such communities are that, I mean, people are here in the community because they share the same taste in music, not because they perhaps have the same political ideas and opinions. So what he found was that there were a lot of conflicts here and politically charged debates from a diversity of political positions. People were not in political agreement, and they discussed their political disagreements here. So this is very much contrast the idea of a filter bubble or homophily, or that in-group polarization, in the sense that in arenas that are particularly target political interested people, it tends to then, people who are on one side on the political spectrum tend to meet, and they become polarized. It becomes a filter bubble. But here, if you come to the platform, to the community, because you have the same taste in music, it doesn't mean that you have the same political opinions. So there is a bigger chance for this diversity of opinions to be expressed and to talk with people who do not have the same opinion as you in these communities. So this and this was also the case of the Kruse study I will return to later. So if we then return to the first lectures here, I mean, individual agency here in this so-called cultural public, online public sphere or cultural participation concerns discussing political issues in non-outspokenly political arenas, painting, performing, creating political art, etc. Yeah? So this is the type of agency we are dealing with here. From a liberal perspective, addressing actors as individuals with preconceived interest. I mean, political art for the sake of fun or for furthering particular individual interest would be one example of that. If we look at it from a deliberative perspective, addressing actors as individuals wanting to reach consensus about the common good. You could, for example, have a thread on a community in a soccer fan club, for example, how to understand racism in society because something happened to an imported, you know, soccer player. So this could be one such thing. Some agency in terms of deliberative democratic perspective view on individual agency. If you look at this from a more social democratic perspective, addressing actors in groups and groups for the provision of equal opportunity, addressing actors in groups for the provision of equal opportunity. Sorry for that. You could see here, you know, common discussers in Kruse, for example, how should we promote LGBT rights? And here on Kruse, it's a dating site, so you can see how these discussions might pop up then in different types of platforms. And then from a radical perspective, you know, viewing actors as groups with interests in conflict with others. I mean, on Kruse, you could take the example of homosexuals should be in opposition to Muslims because they have a different view on sexuality. As an artist, you should fight for the freedom of expression and control in more dictatorial regimes. So this is some way once again, the highlight here, very important, is how do we view actors' motivations? And there are four different ways to look at actors' motivations, even though, the truth is somewhere in between, and we are not clear-cut liberal, deliberative, socialist, radical agents all the time. But I mean, I think it's important to look at this. And then for your group work, how should you, if you indeed intend to use the online cultural public sphere as an arena to incite action, political action with your campaigns, you can have a look at this. And yes, I'm sorry, I could not resist the most current contemporary piece of political art here, the artist Ilma Gore mocking presidential candidate Donald Trump with her picture of him naked, as she views him naked, with the title "Make America Great Again," of course in the sense of mocking him, yeah, diminishing him, making him look ridiculous. I mean, I think he does a pretty good job himself looking ridiculous, but anyway, which is now going to be exhibited in London. It was actually not allowed to be exhibited in the US. But we can see here that cultural participation is increasing. This is an example of that. Is this because of social media making it easier to discuss political issues across social and geographical distances, to mock politicians and spread it, create remix political art, etc.? Perhaps, huh? This could be one explanation. So let's now turn to the chapter in the book, which is very much in line with this. And we have met Todd in his dissertation on wife swap, among other things, before. But we have Scott, Todd, and Dan, who wrote this chapter 5 in the Brunset All book, First Space, Social Media, and Everyday Political Talk. Now, so their starting point, as with the whole cultural participation, online cultural public sphere, as Jokey Hermes and others have been discussing before, is that we should not ignore the everydayness of political communication and engagement. Political talk, which is at the core of their chapter, emerges in processes of everyday talk, but it includes mundane reflections upon power, and possesses the qualities that enable it to contribute to meaningful political actions. So they say that, you know, only by talking, you know, in everyday talk that might have a political nature is very important if we're going to understand political action for opinion formation, etc. And for the argument here, the concept of third space is very important, and they build on Oldenburg's definition, I mean, where he separates the first space, which is home, and the second space, which is work, and the third space would be something in between, you know, where people meet and interact informally. And this third space is very important for this informal political talk, and it's very important for opinion formation, and thus also for political participation and political discussion. Yeah. And this should not, I mean, the first space argument should not be conflated with Habermas' public sphere, where he differentiates also the home, yeah, as one sphere, and then the state, and it's not the work, I mean the state, and then the public sphere, something in between. So first space is more in between home and work in that sense. So yeah, they argue that these spaces are very important because they can foster a connection between your everyday life and politics and the organizational society, and thus also formal politics. So basically, I mean, I think it's a very interesting chapter, but their argument is that everyday political talk is very important to study, yeah, because it's educative, it's where opinions are formed, it has shown to change people's political attitudes, it's where citizens construct their identities, etc. It cultivates political agency, solidarity, communities. So, okay, if we're going to talk about political participation, we should not ignore this. It's very important, everyday political talk. Still, we should be aware that it can be fragmented, anecdotal, messy, but as well, it can be deliberative, as Todd showed in his dissertation. The argument is that, well, everyday political talk needs to be analyzed. It's most likely to take place in so-called first spaces, and Trump verbal here, third spaces could be considered as social media spaces. Social media might be considered as third spaces where political talk might occur. So we should also study social media in terms of third spaces for everyday political talk. And this could be potentially something that is interesting for you for your final examination here on where you should try to map the political, map the academic field to find research questions that have been ignored. And here they clearly outline such a research question. Okay, so let's now turn to my own studies in the field of third spaces, if you so wish, online or in the cultural public, online public sphere, my own studies of cultural participation, which has been conducted on the LGBTQ dating site Cruiser, which you see here. This was my profile page on Cruiser when in 2012, when I conducted most of my research. No, this was not from 2000. This must have been from anyway, this is my profile page on Cruiser, where I conduct my research on Cruiser. So I call myself the researcher, and you see myself here. You put your profile picture, put a picture. You can, you know, send messages, etc. You can flirt with people. So it's basically a dating site. Yeah. And a core of my studies took place in November 2012. And as with Erik Andersson's study of youth community sites, I'm interested in the particular places on cruises where those who are interested in politics are directed. And there are particularly two places on cruises that is important here, and that is the clubs and the forums. Okay. Well, I mean, what is Cruiser? It's the biggest LGBT community in Sweden and in the Nordic region. At the time of in November, it had more than 100,000 members. It's very gay-oriented in terms of the ones who define themselves as men is and youth-oriented. The average age is 33. Well, according to me, that's young, at least. Maybe for you, it's like dinosaur age. But anyway. So some statistics there. Okay, clubs and forums are where politics is mostly discussed here. So what are the clubs? Well, the clubs are, you can join clubs and then you can display them on your, here, laid down here on your profile page, if you want, the clubs that you join. These are clubs for everything. You know, here, some of my clubs that I joined is anti-child pornography, anti-animal cruelty, the atheist, those of us who like to swim, Fever Ray, which is a musical artist, feminism, fair trade, etc. So there are many different types of clubs that you can join, and some of them are clearly political. So, and somewhat reassuring for us intellectuals would be that the biggest club at the time of data gathering in November 2012 was Intelligence is Sexy. Hallelujah. Tightly followed by male nude celebrities. I looked at the clubs during the political clubs, some of the biggest and some of the clubs. The biggest political club was Feminism with 1,095 members. So I followed 13 political clubs, month of November. Very little happened in this club. There was only 79 wall postings and I think two discussion threads. So not a lot happened. And then I also studied forum threads, and there was a particularly one forum, which was called, if I translate, Political Society in the World. And there was a lot more discussion going on, political discussion. There were in total 76 threads, and almost 3,000 postings during the month. So a lot more to study there. And I mean these are some examples of the forum spread. The Austrian school concerns economic. There are is a very bad view of women on Islamic Swedish home sites, etc. Is UN obsolete? So this is the type of discussion that is connected here. So I mean, the research was ethnographic. I was participating there. I also conducted online interviews, did observations, did content analysis, as well as reflective field notation. So this is the kind of battery of methods I used to study the platform. Okay, so if we then look at the results here, studying participation in this online cultural public sphere, starting with the clubs. Now, was kind of easy to analyze, given that there was only 79 wall posting. You can see that it was mostly used for as a notice board to spread information about something, or for to share, to support something. So notice board often contains, and sometimes these were mixed as well, but you know, information about offline events, calls for demonstration, for example, against the Irish abortion legislation was one such common demonstrate with us, information about time and meetings for group, time and place for group meetings, etc. So you see here, the trans group in Gothenburg is meeting, come. Here is a protest against the Irish legislation, come here, with a link to an offline event. So, so you have these kinds of thing going on there, using it as a notice board, but it was also used to share, you know, as some kind of semi or public display of adherence to a cause, showing support for like-minded or particular activities and practices. I mean, one of the examples here is the Thai transsexual flight attendants. So this is, what does it say here? This is the Thai flight attendants that depart from Bangkok's international airport. So this is one of the first transgender-only serviced flight, in the sense that all the flight attendants were transsexual, and it was like, yay, very good. They put transgender issues on the agenda, etc. Or, for example, here, this is like in Uppsala, the transgender clinic in Uppsala is so great. So these kind of things were going on there. Interesting here in terms of hybridity and links to broadcast media is that you could broadcast media, and especially tabloids and daily newspaper, were used in these threads as links, and links almost meant that you were right, or as an argument that you were indeed right, that this was true. So it's kind of, I call it links of verification, and I know Nico has talked about this as a privileged access to truth sometimes, that look, only because you have a link it means you're true. So it was used to confirm the standpoints. You know, here they have a debate about the Maltese EU Commissioner Tonio Borg, that was considered really reactionary, anti-gay, etc. And then they could discuss this, and then they link, but yeah, and he's very, you know, he's like this and that. Look, Aftonbladet, the tabloid, wrote about this, so I'm right. So this was used as a link of verification, to show that you were indeed true, that you had access to the truth. But interesting to see, again, and I think this confirms Chadwick's argument that social media and mass media do not exist independent of each other. They intermingle and exist as in a hybrid, it feeds off each other, etc. It's a hybrid media system. Perhaps the most interesting question to ask, though, is not to look at the participation taking place there, but why no participation took place. I mean, some of this club, nothing happened at all. There was no single wall posting during November 2012 when I gathered data. So then I turned to my interviews to ask, why do you join the club if you're not gonna discuss politics in it? And my finding here is that it was more like display of who you were, as like wearing a pin, you know. In the old days, we wore a pin here, and we could then say like, oh yeah, against the nuclear energy or something, yeah. And I have an example here. So it was more used in this kind of general dating setting to show who you were and what type of person you wanted to meet. Huh? And here are some excerpts from the interviews. The clubs seem mostly to function as a way to show the interest you have. The clubs on cruise are surely used primarily to function as additional information about the user, a list of interest and opinion. Hence, they are a quick way to show where you stand politically. And then there were other interview excerpts like, I don't want to make out with the communists, so therefore I display this, therefore I join these clubs. So yeah, I mean, I didn't include it here, but one of the conference papers I've been written about this is participation. It's called Participation as a Pin, where I especially discuss this function here. If we then continue to the forum threads, a lot more participation were taking place there. I mean, a lot. I mean, I have so much information. And here, I mean, I discuss in an open access article you might want to have a look at from 2014. You can have a look if you want. I discussed that what motivated participation here, and a lot, was what I call participation frames, and this goes back to the action frames that we discussed in the last lecture concerning activism, or you could use the term perhaps discourses as well. So there were particularly two frames that were inciting participation, that spurred, you know, ignited participation. And the one was the left versus the right. So, I mean, right-wing poster talks about the left riffraff's confused worldviews, or how socialist Sweden has decided it's ugly to work, etc. Whereas on the other side, left-wing poster would say, call the female minister in the then alliance government as Burgess bitches, you know, the Burgess pack, and markedly Burrows as authoritarian bullies. And this is one, also a picture from one of the forum threads, mocking, paraphrasing the scrape lottery ticket Tris, but they call it piss instead, as a critique of the then conservative government. From the interview excerpt you have here, one example how this frame really spurred, ignited participation, really set the chord, something like really made people interested to debate if they felt they were attacked along this side. It's almost exclusively socialists of various colors that participate in the debates here, so a different perspective is needed. Someone who believes in freedom. So this, the idea here that the left versus the right is very much igniting participation in this frame here, or political discussion. The other main participation frame was the xenophobes versus the multiculturalist, or if you wish, the unafraid truth tellers, according to themselves, versus the politically correct elite, or the politically correct mafia. So you had posts who referred to municipalities having to shut down elderly care units at the same time as they received refugees, draining the welfare system without contributing to it. The opponents, in their turn, argues that there is no such thing as free immigration, and not even refugees can assume a safe haven in Sweden. And you had pictures like this, Nazism and Sweden flag connected, Nazi flag and Swedish flag connected. And in interview excerpt here from one of the unafraid truth tellers here, asking him, her, what she thought, why she engaged in discussion, and ask, because when I interact with nicknames, I'm not always sure if it's a man or a woman. Most likely it's a man, but anyway, stating, I engage in discussion that concerns Sweden, its duration as a nation and as a home for the Swedish people, contra the multiculturalists. So this was also frame that sparked a lot of participation, ignited a lot of discussion on the forum here. And here, I mean, something that I found particularly interesting in this frame is the what they call the home Islamophobia phobia. So obviously, not surprisingly, the religion of Islam here was considered as particularly evil, and Muslims as particularly unfit for to function in Swedish society, and even unwanted in the Swedish society. And the idea here with cultural relativism was that Christianity or Judaism or any other religion or culture and Islam were measured with different yardsticks, that you know, Muslim could get away with so much more than other religions. And this also relates to discussions within the LGBT literature. There is this Puar who has written about something he called homonationalism in 2007, where especially Muslims are articulated as threats to LGBTQ persons. Who are and then are embraced by and embrace nationalist agendas. Yeah, you see here a really radical two groups against each other from a radical perspective. And from the there was this idea that people were afraid of Islamophobes and that you were not allowed to express any criticism against Islam. And this is an example here from the interviews. The subordination of women has worsened recently by cultural relativism and the sprawl of Islamophobia phobia, the belief that all cultures are equally good and that we could not criticize Islam as it would be prejudiced and racist. So it's general discontent that you were not allowed to criticize Islam. And resonating with the findings in the clubs, there was also this idea of having a privileged access to facts. And so people were not really deliberating here in these forums. There was a lot of conflicts between, you know, different poles in these frames. And it was not like they were willing to listen to each other's argument. Instead, they had access to the facts, which could be verified with a link to a tableau, yeah? And they better listen to it. And they then felt that they had to share these facts. So it was a tendency to preach to participants the truth, and if you didn't get the truth, you were basically an idiot. Yeah. So, I mean, this is some examples here from the interview. So, I mean, this thread had 90% lies, so I had to correct this. I had to start the counter thread. And another, to answer your question, who I want to because I mean, in an interview, I would talk to someone who said, like, oh, I want everyone to discover the shortcomings of his, her argument, this XX here, I've anonymized it. And then I asked, I mean, who do you want to discover this? Because they were obviously not talking to each other on the platform. And the nickname then answers here, to answer your question for who I want to discover the shortcomings of XX argumentation, those who still can be influenced. And this is a very interesting finding I found, because clearly the participants, the discussants here were not expecting to convince or reach some sort of consensus with each other. They were addressing someone else. An audience of lurkers, someone who's lurking around these platforms, they thought that they could still be influenced. And you are also not expected to participate if you did not have any opinions clearly formulated. Yeah. So this was very interesting. Yeah, they had access to facts, and they were not trying to convince their opponents. They were trying to convince others who still could be influenced, so-called lurkers. They were believing that there was an audience of lurkers who were generally impressed by their argumentation. And then, as in the article that is provided for the class that I was published last year, I also discussed participation as a pastime here. Why was this so conflictual? Why were they fighting so much? Well, because they were having fun. They were passing their time there. And it's much more fun to mock opponents than to reason towards some kind of consensus on an agreement. And to attack each other was to be acknowledged as players in the game here. And there are some examples from my interviews. I participated because I'm bored. It's a pastime. It's fun to tease the left. Huh? When you're bored, so you kind of go there and ignite the flaming discussions. Huh? And no one censors you here. It's so much more fun. So it's, you know, so this was also an important aspect of the political talk in this so-called third space or online public sphere, and that people did this because it was fun. They was having the time of their life. Yeah. If I haven't provoked anyone, I haven't affected anything. As I said here. So provocation was part of the game here. I mean, when I studied it, it was generally a very depressing moment in my life because there were so many attacks and I was attacked and you know, I didn't quite get it until, you know, I finally realized that this is a game, yeah? They are just having fun. I managed to provoke people. So participation as a pastime. And then finally, I also want to discuss, because I got money last year from a foundation concern who gives money for the enlightenment of issues of homosexuality. So I got money this semester to write. So I've written two book chapters. And one, which was submitted, will come out hopefully this year in an anthology about LGBTs and social media in Europe. And here, the question is, I mean, what role? I called the article, well, I mean, the book chapter we call Gay the Correct Way. And it was, yeah, I'm still awaiting it has been reviewed, it's been submitted, it should be out in the Routledge anthology this year. Anyway, the question here is, what is the role of sexual identity in this conflictual participation? That they were gay, how did this matter? And this was a very interesting study to make, because when I returned to my material collected in 2012, it seemed very little. I mean, sexual identity was rarely referred to at all. It seemed to play a very little role. I mean, what played a role for the participation was this polarizing participation frames. This came first. And then it seemed, the more I spent time with the material, and that sexual identity came in second to kind of confirm your standpoint in this polarization frame. Like, if you're gay, you're an idiot if you're not to the left, or if you're gay, you're an idiot to defend Muslims, etc. So as if there was one politically correct way of being gay, hence the title of this chapter. And this is an example from the interviews, and some of the interviews have been ongoing, so I have been interviewing people afterwards also about this. I'm overall tired of ignorance, and I'm become even more tired as an LGBT when cruisers allowed Facebook-less trolls to sit here and spread racism and coarse lies on an LGBT site. It's an insult to us who have fought for our rights. First, the right wing work against us, then we have to put up with them on our community. No. Okay, so it's kind of basically the right has never fought for gay rights, so therefore it's you cannot hold right-wing positions. But the thing that is, and the conclusion I make in the article is also that, of course there is, I mean, and what Cruiser shows, there is no right way or correct way of being gay. There is many politically opinions you can hold as gay, thank God. Huh? So I argue against this, of course. And I developed this argument paraphrasing the very feminist the very famous feminist slogan, "The personal is political," from the 70s here. And instead, because it seems like your political opinions come first and then you add your gay identity to justify your positions within this participation frame. So I argue that no, the personal is not, I mean, the personal is political, but the political is also made personal. Well, it's personalized here. Your political opinions are personal. You use your own story, your own identity to justify your political standpoints. You personalize your political standpoints. Huh? So, you can connect this to Maria Bakardieva's idea of mundane citizenship, that, you know, when you extend the political to the personal domain, to allowing the political to permeate all spaces of the everyday. So you're allowing political positions, discussion into the everyday, into the cultural public sphere. And this is one example from my interview series. Sex is no more interesting than politics. But as a single older gay man, Cruiser is one of the few venues where one can deal with both at the same time. So people were, yeah, making their, conflating their sexual identity with the political in interesting ways here, which is then my second conclusion in this book chapter. That will come out in Routledge very soon, hopefully. And the third conclusion is, and here I draw about a Kuntzman idea of queer flaming. The idea that flaming, you know, that flame wars that you fight and that it's very antagonistic online and hate speech, etc. And flame, I think, is very, it's a very good metaphor because you can talk about the participation frames, the polarizing participation frames as igniting flames of actions and in trolling, etc. But she argues, and I think this is a thing to this, that flaming and queerness goes very well together. Think about drag shows, for example, or cliches of gay men in the movies. So there is this performance of mannered and theatrical rudeness that is particularly connected to, in general, gay men. So gay queer flaming here, that perhaps the antagonism here, I mean, and you know, in Todd, well, in Scott Todd and Dan's chapter for in the course literature, chapter 5, they argue that it's not as flaming in the cultural in third spaces. My findings suggest differently. Maybe this is because it's a queer site, yeah? It's a gay site, and gay men are particularly inclined towards this flaming mode. And as one example from the interview here, most of us here in the forum enjoy our conflicts and our vendettas, huh? A little. Conflicts can be stimulating, entertaining, especially if you have nothing else. I mean, the pastime again. So I think this is a very interesting, perhaps, finding as well. So in this sense, this genre of queer flaming is also a sign of belonging. Yeah? That, and it's a sign that, you know, you by participating in this kind of performing this genre, you're also performing your belongingness to the community. Okay, and finally, a chapter that I sent off to my language reviewer 2 days ago. So this is very fresh in my mind, that I've been working on this semester on this same material, something that I wanted to, and I got the opportunity when I was asked by Todd actually to participate in a book project of his. So I was particularly interested in the role of the lurkers here. I mean, remember that the participants said that they didn't address each other, they didn't deliberate with each other, they were instead wanting to impress this imagined, or well, sometimes imagined, sometimes not, I mean, audience of lurkers here, that they thought that there was a lot of participants lurking the forum who were impressed by the arguments, yeah? And as this excerpt from the interview, you don't win over excess in this way, it's making more people understand the big gaps in his argumentation. So they would thinking they could convince someone else. So I was thinking about, what is the relationship between lurkers and more active participants here? How are we to understand this? What is the role of the lurker for the active participant in making his or her participation meaningful? Then I asked, is this, it comes close to think that they are an imagined audience, but they were sometimes, in the interviews, participants said that, oh no, I mean, some people write to me and say, oh, thank you for your argumentation, really was very enlightening, etc. I'm discussing this chapter, lurkers and lurking, but also the concept of the imagined audience. And I ask myself whether this is a fantasy of theirs. I mean, is this a fantasy, this idea of lurkers? Huh? And this is where then I turn to a French philosopher, psychoanalytic, Jacques Lacan, who is completely impossible to read. So I talk about Lacan-inspired analysis because I didn't read him properly. I was influenced by people who were influenced by him in turn. So he's famous for his very difficult language, and he didn't really write anything himself. It's just people who took down his lecture notes. So that's why I talk about Lacan-inspired analysis. And because he talks about fantasy, but fantasy is a little bit different in his analytical framework here. So in his framework, the individual is split from the source of enjoyment, causing a lack in the individual. This enjoyment has been stolen by the other, and therefore the individual desires for the enjoyment. And the fantasy, according to Lacan, is then created to cope with this lack. The enjoyment is still impossible to fully reach, but we still desire enjoyment, and we create this fantasy to cope with this to this lack. And here they refer to Zizek, who say that for the anti-Semite, what she desires is a world without Jews. Yeah? But if all Jews would disappear, I mean, he could no longer be an anti-Semite, or she could no longer be an anti-Semite, because then there would be no use. So I mean, the fantasies or the enjoyment is impossible to fully reach, and the enjoyment split enjoyment is also, or the lack of enjoyment is also constituting the political identity. So reading Lacan here, I'm new to Lacan, so I'm a little bit like Bambi on slippery ice here, but it seemed to me that the lurkers as such then is not the fantasy, but the belief in persuasion is, that you actually can persuade everyone to side on you with the political issue. So let me see, I'll test this argument on you and see if you agree with me. This is where I still have time to improve and better it, because I get it back from my language reviewer, so your opinions really could be helpful here. So okay, so what is the enjoyment here? Well, I argue in this chapter that the enjoyment is a society where the correct political opinions prevail. I mean, this participant had this privileged access to the facts, to the truth, and they were preaching these right attitudes. I stand up for knowledge, justice, and enlightenment, and show facts. People had this privileged access to fact. So rather than to discuss with other active participants, they were motivated to share their facts they had access to. But not everyone knew the fact. Therefore, participants had to share them to tell the truth and argue for the correct opinions. So this is what they strive for. A society where everyone shares their correct opinions. And why do not people share this opinion? Because they don't have access to the fact that as they had. So, however, I mean, once again, if everyone were to be persuaded, there would be no political dividing lines. There would be no left versus the right. There would be no xenophobe versus Islamophobes, xenophobes versus the correct mafia, politically correct mafia or multiculturalist. So it's impossible. Like a world without Jews is impossible for an anti-Semite. The same thing is here for this participant. The world where everyone is persuaded is impossible. So the split here then, which occurs when separated for the enjoyment, shapes the subject. And the fantasy is created in order to cope with the lack the split has given rise to, a promise to fulfill and thus reach enjoyment, however full enjoyment cannot be reached, as I said. So, but what kept the desire alive then? I mean, there is, and this is where I think the lurkers enter into the argument. And because since they could not convince the other active participants, I mean, there is, this could then lead to, like, it's impossible, I cannot reach enjoyment anyway, there is nothing that keeps the desire alive for the full enjoyment, the society where everyone shares your opinion. And here I then think that the lurkers fulfill this role of keeping the desire alive. So and this is why I argue that the fantasy is not so much about the lurkers as such, but that you could persuade other people. So the belief in an audience of undecided lurkers is a sign that, or is something that keeps the desire alive for full enjoyment. Do you follow me? I mean, it's a little bit complicated perhaps, but this is my argument here. Okay. Let's finish off then. So, in my studies here, you have followed them, of Nina on the net, the bathhouse course in Aspudden in southern Stockholm, and my cruiser studies. Is there anything I can conclude in general when it comes to political participation and social media? Well, I have kind of summarized my finding in an article in International Journal of Media and Cultural Politics. And I summarize my finding along three concepts: connective individualism, expressive issue engagement, and disciplined updating, which I think are concepts that we could build further upon in order to discuss social media and political participation. Starting with connective individualism, well, I mean, it's obvious that you need others to be yourself. So the connection, to connect with others, is very important. And Bennett and Segerberg has talked about connective action and connectivity. The use of Twitter and social media for connectivity is very much important. So negotiating yourself as politically interested, engaging, is about intertwining yourself with others, group networks, crowds, frames, if you so wish, such as discourses, such as the left versus the right. And I think this is very important, this so-called connective individualism. And with this concept, I also want to discuss these dividing lines in political philosophy today between, for example, those who argues that individualism is too much focused on the individual. But I would say that individualism is not. I mean, you cannot be an individual without the others. You need the connection to others, hence the connective individualism. But in a sense, this is not collective identity in the traditional sense that we have the same collective identity as members of the union or political parties any longer. It's different in that sense. It's more fluid. It's more connective. Huh? So in that sense, I connect to this idea of connective action versus collective action. So connective individualism is kind of one of the major threads I see. The second would be something I called expressive issue engagement. So we see with social media a continued focus on issue engagement, instead of larger political platforms, parties. Even if these issues may be, you know, framed within larger discourses or frames such as the left versus the right, the bottom up versus the elite, etc. And I also think that the participation frames also underline some of the arguments within the issue engagement, that some issues motivate participation or ignite flaming discussion more than others. So this, and I think this, with adding the expressive here, is that this is often reflexively chosen. It's connected to the connective individualism, that it's done in order to express, sustain, and negotiate the story of the political selves. So this idea of expressive individualism is something that I want to work on further in the future as well. And then finally, something I call disciplined updating. Could there be a logic of updating? I mean, I think we've seen it in the chapter from the activism part of the book, and also from my own studies of Asput and how this constant updating, like what's happening, what's going on. Yeah, not so much to create own news or to create own information and spread, but to be updated on things. And it seems like social media, there is something in social media that pushes us to be updated. There is something in the design of the medium that does this. So in that sense, and if we connect to issues that are important in the expression of ourselves, in the negotiation of our political identity, when we connect to others, this kind of pushes us to be updated on this issue. So I talk about of the idea that this could be disciplining in the Foucauldian understanding of the term, that you could discipline us to be updated, that we actually pushed to be updated. So this is another thing that I'm thinking about, perhaps exploring in the future. All right, so I have been talking a lot about my own work, as usual, I'm sorry for that. I hope you have some interesting points to discuss, especially about my later works where I'm eager to hear your opinions and perhaps develop and better my arguments. I know that some of the theoretical frameworks I use might be considered a bit difficult, but I'm very happy to discuss it and explain it further in class if there was something you didn't understand. So if there is something you didn't understand, do contact me. And do also, if you're coming to class, do email me and tell me what you would like to discuss. And even if you understand everything, there still might be something you find more interesting than others, perhaps the fantasy part or the logic of updating, etc. So I can group you together on basis of that. Okay, take care.